Good evening, everybody. It's July 1st, 2021. It's Azure Thursday. And Esther, they did it. They are letting us host, the two of us.
Yeah, who made that happen?
Well, somebody decided it was a good idea, so here we go.
Well, I think it's a good idea. After the last time I took over the show, it's good to now have a co-host right from the beginning. So I'm really enjoying teaming up with you, Roel.
Yeah, I heard it was also appreciated that when you joined the time before last time, you introduced one of the guests as your what was it, your swag swindler or something like that.
I remember that one too. Yeah, I'm very good at introducing our presenters. Yes, maybe that's something I need to work on just a little bit.
I think you're doing fine. So today we have three presenters, actually. The first session will be two gentlemen, and I guess I'll just let you introduce them.
Yeah, sure. Let's bring them on. Tech support. And so hi, guys.
Good evening.
Hi.
Yes, I guess I need to confess that Patrick and I do have a small history together. But I'm very excited to have Patrick and Rick join us tonight to present the cool work that they are doing on what I like to call transitioning from traditional admin roles to a more DevOps focused role. And I guess not everyone is aware that Patrick and I have a history in end user computing. And I think for us, well, maybe it's just me, but I think at least the way I see it, end user computing was one of the pioneers that already realized that if we want to transition to a cloud, we needed to adapt automated deployments, automated configurations. So how did that work for you, Patrick?
Yeah, for me too. And it started eventually with automating installation when I was a small kid in the XP time. Then I just bought two CD players. And when somebody in the street has a problem with his computer, they just bring the computer and I just put the CDs in. So it will automatically install the computer of my neighbor. And then I can go to the gym while installing that and earning $50.
Nice.
So that knowledge I bring into the end user computing by just building golden images. It was be a mentality for me, like if I need to do it twice, I automate it because I'm lazy by nature. Now we're doing with Rick a very cool Azure DevOps project in the end user computing space. And then I also realized that, wow, when doing end-user computing, you also touch a lot of components. Like we're operating in the sixth layer of the OC model, in the presentation layer. And if you do everything, you need to automate from networking towards desktop delivery and how a user is opening Outlook. So, yeah, that's really cool.
That's awesome. So one of the things that I learned in the short history that I have with Rick is that he not just focuses on the technology, but he also takes the processes and the learning or the journeys that, well, traditional admins have to make to adapt to new technologies and new automation styles, new skills, new competences. So I really love seeing you in action, Rick. Or feel privileged that I get to see you in action in motivating and getting the team enthusiastic about these new cool things to explore. So how do you feel about that?
It's a steep learning curve. And I'm glad you're on board now. So we haven't worked a lot together yet, but I'm sure the future will bring us a lot of fun. I see there's a steep learning curve for people. And I think if you understand the process, then the technology is second. Then it doesn't matter in what method or how you're going to do it. If the process is good, then the technology will follow and the end result will be there.
Yeah, adaptation becomes easier if the processes are in place.
Correct, yeah.
That yeah. makes sense.
Yeah.
Well, with that short introduction, because I know you added at least one slide in the presentation on introducing yourself, all I guess that's left to say is, guys, take it away, and we'll meet you after the presentation for some Q&A.
Thank you.
So I will start the session. So welcome, everybody, to our session about deploying Windows 10 multi-session with Azure DevOps, Terraform, and Packer. And Rick and I decided to make this session since we had a steep learning curve moving away from a traditional sysadmin, which are doing end-user computing, to a modern approach via Azure DevOps, Agile, and Scrum. In this presentation, we have a lot of topics which are a presentation itself. So our goal of this presentation is to give you an overview of all the possibilities, what you can do with Azure DevOps, Terraform, and Packer. So you can start with it from the beginning, because there is a lot of new things to learn if you start with this new approach. So first, let introduce myself. I'm Patrick van der Born. I'm an independent consultant and architect in the Netherlands. I'm also active in the community, and I'm very proud that Citrix rewarded me with the Citrix Technology Professional title. I'm also known and member of Team RGE. That's such a bunch of GPU nerds. So we're doing things with the GPU. I'm also a member of Go AUC, and basically there I'm also automating the lab deployments and doing a lot of public cloud researches for performance of end-user computing. If you want to reach out after this session to me, you can just send me an email, follow me on Twitter, contact me on LinkedIn, or start reading my blog. And I will give it to you to my partner in crime, Rick.
Yeah, thank you, Patrick. My name is Rick Steinman. I work for one of the big Dutch banks. Yeah, you see my Twitter, LinkedIn website, and email as well on screen. I don't have a lot of other titles than that, but I will take over the presentation. Yeah, we have an big agenda. I'll take you to the journey to a DevOps Scrum approach. And then we'll give some context about Windows 10 multi-session with Azure DevOps pipelines, and Patrick will have two interesting sessions about infrastructure as code and image as code, and of course we're open for any Q&A. So speaking about our DevOps journey, I work at a large organization, and back in the day, 2019, we started basically within our organization with DevOps teams, and that meant basically that we put the developers and operations together, and we called it DevOps. But then we found out that that was not enough. And then we improved that by adding Scrum Masters, product owners, have a team backlog, and really adapting the Agile and Scrum framework. 2021, we started with the real DevOps journey, and it's still ongoing. And if we speak about DevOps, traditionally, especially in a big enterprise organization, what we have seen in the past is the way we did it is that we basically gave always an engineer a task or a group or a team. and then we let that engineer start to work in a dev environment, because you don't hit production once. And then you start developing basically in the GUI. Once he was happy with it, he started in a UAT or an acceptance environment, and doing all the work all over again. And then bring it to production. That's basically, in a nutshell, the way we did it for years, which was fine because we were really good at it. No issues with that. But it's not really efficient if you look at the process. If you look at how we do it in the DevOps way, then basically all those environments are locked in code, and we've got create one configuration file, and the parameters are from the Azure DevOps repository brought to the environment via pipeline. And that means less work for that admin. So basically, if you look at the admin, the way how he works will change. So basically, from using a GUI and logging his changes in an ITSM environment, using a file with a copy, going through all the stages by hand, then his work will change, because we ask now that engineer to change that way of working by moving his work to an Azure DevOps repository, because we have a philosophy, everything as code. So that engineer is coding, and that pipeline is taking over his work by logging the changes and going through the environments. And of course, one of the big advantages what I see in we use Azure DevOps, and there are different DevOps tools around, but we're locked in with Microsoft in this one, is the test plans. So we basically go through all the stages as soon as the tests are passed. So why are we doing it? Because I said, we've done it before in the old-fashioned way. Why are we doing DevOps now? First, we want to automate everything, but also if you do it good, then you have a faster delivery of that configuration, and by using code, the quality control of that configuration is higher. It's less repeated work, so you type it once and then it goes through the environments, but gives less issues, what results in less calls on the help desk, less ad hoc work, but it has an impact on the team. And I've seen it myself, people working 15 years in IT, 20 years, even more, going from GUI based to coding, it's a big change. It fully integrates with Agile, and we are really focus on the process instead of doing the ad hoc work. Basically, you want to go from DevOps to NoOps. But one of the things is, if it's a steep learning curve, if you do this, then you have to make mistakes. And by those mistakes, you can learn and improve. And that's something we see in our teams every day who are adopting this way of working.
We never make mistakes, Rick, right?
Yeah, that's for us. That's for us now. That's a question when I have a lot from what is this pipeline? What is code? Now, basically, if we're talking about a pipeline, and you will see it later on also in Patrick's videos, it's basically a set of jobs written in a JAML file. And the goal is to build a code as described, as it is in the repository, so our source code, and it's basically delivery of the configuration.
Rick, and this is also a slide, and we added this in because when I started at the Rabobank, you had a funny story, and I was also a traditional sysadmin, and maybe it's worth to share it with the audience here about how you deployed your first network on Azure.
Yeah, that was basically one of my first touches with Azure DevOps. I was tasked to get an VNet in our subscription, and we have a big cloud competence center, and basically they do everything DevOps. And I went to one of those network engineers, and I said, hey, can I get a VNet connected over Express? And basically said, yeah, you can go to this repository, and then you fork it, and then you change, and then you do some commits in the parameter file, and then you create a pipeline, and then you build that, and then it will be delivered. And I was like, okay, I'm working for a long time in IT, but what's this? What did I miss? Which strain did I miss? Yeah, and then he left at me. And he left a few times, and they said, "Okay, I will show you what I mean, and I will show you what how this works and what I mean with all those terms." And then basically, I was forced in this way of working because the other part of the organization was already doing this. But a lot of those terms now on the screen, like cherry picking, pull, pass, was all new to us. And nowadays, if you hear our daily stand-ups, for example, this is common terminology now.
Yeah, I think we mention each word multiple times a day here now. So
it's
a bit funny.
Yeah. Yeah.
So basically, and also for me, the DevOps journey started here from a traditional IT guy. And to give you some context about our project, we are tasked to deploy a Windows 10 multi-session environment via Azure DevOps pipelines on Azure. And basically, in our project, we defined three sub-projects. We call this pillars. So the first one, and that's the lowest layer of the LC model, is infrastructure as code. And we're using HashiCorp Terraform for this. And since we're using Citrix as our brokering platform, we deploy, for example, our Citrix Cloud Connectors, which are Azure VMs, and also the Azure NetApp files, our networking, key vaults, and our shared image gallery via HashiCorp Terraform. The second pillar in a project is image as code. And for image as code, we're using HashiCorp Packer. And we're tasked to deploy our images on multiple platforms. So we still have VMware vSphere on Windows Server 2019 in an on-premises data center. So we can use published applications which are only allowed from our own data center. We are also able to make images for Microsoft Azure, Windows 10 multi-session, which is based on the AVD images. And in the future, we're digging in to deploy our images on Amazon AWS, where we can do a Windows 10 single session for our developers. The third pillar we defined in our project is desktop as code. And with desktop as code, we're describing the Citrix Cloud configuration as code. And we're using for this PowerShell, APIs, or the Citrix automated configuration tool. And basically, we're configuring there is the Citrix virtual apps and desktop servers, but also resource locations, zones, and machine catalogs, etc. But I think if this is not an end-user computing thing, this is the boring pillar. If you want to do Azure Virtual Desktop as code, that's also possible, and you could use HashiCorp Terraform for this. There is a desktop virtualization provider and resource you can use, but you can also use PowerShell. When I started this project, my tool set expanded a lot. So the green boxes are the only boxes I knew when I started the project, but these are the tools we're using daily. So basically Git, which will check in and check out the code, and it's integrated in Visual Studio Code. We're using Azure DevOps, so repository, pipelines, and self-hosted agents. We're also using the boring stuff, which I don't noted in the presentation, like boards and all that kind of stuff. HashiCorp Terraform, Packer, PowerShell, Citrix Automated Configuration Tool, and Azure Key Vaults. So this is our tool set we're using on the project. If we look at the context of a project, I think at first we want to onboard 4,500 users around the globe. We now deployed the first users in Australia, and we're now busy deploying it in Europe. And I think at the end of the year, we will start in the America region. The goal of this project is to do everything as code, using Azure DevOps pipelines. And in our project, it's mandatory to use YAML pipelines. Since we need to save everything as code, the YAML pipelines are stored in an Azure DevOps repository, and they are source controlled that way. If you're using the GUI, then your pipeline is not source controlled. So that's why we're not allowed to use GUI
pipelines or release pipelines, since release pipelines, you cannot specify them in YAML. The last project, the project goal is that we have zero touch interfaces. So our sysadmins at the end don't have admin rights in Azure, and also no admin rights in Citrix Cloud. So it's mandatory for them to change things via code. So everything is logged in the pipeline log, for example. So let's dig in to the first technical stuff with Terraform. And if you never used infrastructure as code, then it's very handy to know the difference between a declarative approach, and that's basically what Terraform is, and an imperative approach, which is basically as a scripting language. So with a declarative approach, the programmer specified what is to be computed. So for example, I want a hamburger with bacon, onion, and barbecue sauce. So if I specify it that way, the system will automatically detect and know what to do to give you a hamburger with bacon, onion, and barbecue sauce. And on the other hand, Terraform is also having an idempotent approach. So if I ask it multiple times for a hamburger with bacon, onion, and barbecue sauce, it will detect I already have one and tells me like, hey, Patrick, you have to watch your calories. You already have one hamburger, so I won't give you a second one until you finish your first. If we look to an imperative approach, then the programmer will specify how it's to be computed. So for example, you have to define the whole flow. So are there hamburgers? If so, get it, put it on the fire, wait until done, etc., etc. And also the things in the flow when it's go wrong, for example, if it burns or the fire is too hot. So in my perspective, if you start with infrastructure as code, it's way easier to start with a declarative approach, because you can specify more in what you want and not how to get it. When we started this project, we also did some software selection. And since the first platform to use is Microsoft Azure, we make a comparison between different tools. And we've selected HashiCorp Terraform over Microsoft Arm, or nowadays Bicep. And basically why we selected Terraform is that we have a dependency of a multi-platform support. And if you want to use Microsoft Arm or Bicep, then you have a Microsoft login, and this is only used for deployments on Azure. And since, for example, we also need to deploy things on vSphere or maybe later on AWS, it's also good for our engineers that they only have to learn Terraform to deploy resources on those multiple platforms. So they are not getting bored about, okay, if I want to deploy something on Azure, I need to learn Arm or Bicep. And if I want to deploy things on vSphere, I need to dig into the VMware Power CLI. Both is a declarative approach, but you can use both for redeployment. And basically, if you look to ARM, the first time I tried to understand ARM and to create an ARM template, it took me about 1 or 2 weeks, and it's a massive JSON object. And the first time I've deployed a virtual machine on Azure with Terraform, I was done within one and a half hours. And I was thinking like, wow, this is like magic. And I think Microsoft is also getting this, and they created a very cool tool, Microsoft Bicep. And Bicep is basically, in my opinion, it looks a lot familiar as Terraform, but it generates ARM, those complex ARM templates for you. Another advantage from Terraform above, for example, Microsoft Bicep, is that there is a plan stage. And a plan stage, you can see it like some kind of what-if scenario. So if you've declared all your resources in code,
you can do Terraform plan, and Terraform will tell you what it's going to do. Like, I'm going to destroy 3 resources, I'm going to add 2 resources, and I'm going to change these resources. And if you're okay with that, then you can apply the configuration to the real world. If you want to use Terraform, you can just go to the website, and this is just a quick screenshot of all, some of the providers they support, and there are a lot. So they basically support AWS, Azure, GCP, Oracle, Alibaba, and you can even deploy things on Azure Stack or in your Active Directory. And for us, it's also for VMware vSphere. The documentation of Terraform is very good. So if you just click a provider, and maybe this is a little bit small, but on the left-hand side, you see all these services on Azure in this case, which you can deploy with Terraform. So if you want to deploy a CDN or container services, you just click on it, and on the right side, you get examples of all the resources and parameters you can define for that particular resource. And normally if you go to the documentation and you want to deploy something, you're finished within literally some hours. If you do desktop virtualization like Azure Virtual Desktop, there's also a desktop virtualization provider, and then you can deploy resources for Azure Virtual Desktop. So in this case, a virtual desktop host pool, which is the equivalent of the Citrix machine catalog. So you can just specify it this way, and then it will create a host pool for you on Azure. Terraform is using the HashiCorp 2 language, and basically it's very easy to configure. So this is an example of deploying an Azure Windows virtual machine on Azure. So basically first you define resource, then what resource, on this type it's Azure RM Windows Virtual Machine, and you give your object a label. So in this case, my first Azure Virtual Machine. And then you can specify all the parameters for this resource. So you have to give this virtual machine a name, so my first Azure VM, and you need to specify in which resource group the virtual machine will live. So In HashiCorp 2 language, you can make reference between the different resources you want to deploy. So for example, on the right-hand side, if you defined a resource group resource with the label main, and you give it a name and a location in West Europe, you can reference it here, like Azure RM resource group, what's the type, dot the label, so this is main, and dot the name. So it will automatically fill in the name here. And the same is here for the location. So if I change my code, for example, the location to North Europe, then this virtual machine will pick this up automatically, and I don't have to change this on multiple lines. So this makes the coding and describing your resources in Terraform very easy. If we go down here, we specify the size. So this is an F2, an admin username and a password. This is not the way how we do it in code, but it's okay for the example. And we're building from a marketplace template in this example, 2016 with the latest version. And we specified an OS disk of HHD with the caching and read-write mode. So this is all the code you need to just deploy a virtual machine on Azure. And because this session is not 2 hours long, so I ripped the Terraform demo out of it. But in the end, if you deploy this amount of code, the end result is just a virtual machine that everybody knows on Azure. So it's as simple as that. If we dig into the images code with Packer, so we basically want to build an immutable image. And again, we started to start with the tool selection.
And since our first images are on Azure, we selected HashiCorp Packer. Like HashiCorp Packer again has a multi-platform support, and the Azure Image Builder has a vendor login because it's Azure only. And with HashiCorp Packer, we can deploy our images on Azure, AWS, and vSphere, like one of our project goals. One thing is image as code. Both are image as code, so you can describe your images as code, and maybe I defined they're simple and complex. So this is simple, and I think simplish. Like Azure Image Builder is like an umbrella around Packer. It also used Packer under the hood, and I was thinking like, hey, Packer is so simple. So I think how can you make things even more simple? And I dare to say, but unfortunately, this is not an in-person event when we can drink a beer at the bar and discuss this, is that maybe Packer is a little bit easier to handle than the Azure Image Builder. Again, we're using the HashiCorp tool language here. So that's also easy for our admins. So they just need to learn one language to deploy infrastructure and images. And basically, if you want to define a Packer template, which is basically your image description, we have three sections. So the first section is variables. That's where we declare all our variables. So in this example, it's an Azure AD application ID with the type string, and in this case, a default random value, and a source, which is the Azure Image Builder, and later on more. So basically, this is the machine which will create the image. And here I make a link to the variable. So the client ID for the Azure Image Builder has a link to var.aad underscore application ID, which is this variable. The third section is actually the build. And I explain this more like a task sequence. Like I'm more from a traditional world, where we use, for example, Ivanti automation, SCCM or MDT, and see this like a task sequence. So basically, the build first is sources, so where to build it. So this is on Azure. And the other ones are provisioners. So basically, this provisioner is executed first, which is actually a PowerShell script with just the right verbs, and a provisioner of file, which actually uploads a file to the image. And when the build is done, that's your image. But I will show you a demo of this later in the session. So some terms of Packer, and the first one is a builder. So a Packer builder is actually a machine, a temporary machine, which will build the image. So here is that guy who's controlling the buttons, and you can build this on multiple platforms. So on the left-hand side there, they're the most common. So AliCloud, Amazon, Azure, GCP. You can even do it on-premises, on Hyper-V or Nutanix or VMware vSphere. And you can start with it, if you want to start with it today, on your own machine for free to just install VirtualBox. And then you can just download the packer.exe from the website, and you can start building images on your laptop. There are also a lot of other platforms I don't know. That's on the right-hand side. Maybe there's one you're using. But hey, I'm a Citrix guy, and there's also support for Citrix Hypervisor, also known as SAN Server. If we dig into the provisioners install and configure software on that build, on the temporary builder, as a task sequence, as I also mentioned in the HashiCorp tool language example. So for if we are deploying a Windows image, these are three are the most used provisioners: files for up and downloading files, PowerShell for executing PowerShell scripts, Windows Shell for executing command line, and if you need a reboot after installation, you can just insert the Windows restart, and then Packer will wait until the builder VM will come online. if you do Citrix, for example, it's also a possibility to deploy Linux VDAs, so Linux workers instead of Windows, and you can also use Packer to build your Linux images. And if you're more into other tools, we're now looking into Ansible. That's a declarative approach of, for example, installation. You can also deploy an Ansible playbook with Packer. So Packer will just execute the Ansible playbook, and that's the end result of your of your immutable image. But hey, if you're more into Chef or Puppet or Salt, then you can also use that. If we look to this example, we just basically install three applications via PowerShell provisioner. So basically, first FSLogix is installed, and when it's done, it will install Office 365. And when that's done, it will install Team Machine-Wide Installer. With Packer, we can also give some environment variables to watch the execution. So those environment variables with their values are available during a script execution on the builder VM. And we can specify the context of where the script is executed. So if you need to execute an installation script in a different context, you can just specify the username and password over there, and the script will be executed in that context. From a pipeline and a CI/CD perspective, we are passing lots of pipeline variables to those environment variables and context execution, so we can make things dynamically build up over there. So that's a possibility to link them. The end result, when everything is done, will be, in this case, an image on Azure, or it's a managed image, an image in your shared image gallery, or for Citrix, we still need to have a VHD on a storage account. And that's just how you specify the outcome. And I now will show you a pre-recorded demo of how to do this, so you can see this in real life. And I think my colleagues will now send you a text message in the chat. So if you're in a region or on a link where the connection is bad or you see artifacts, you can see this demo movie on YouTube after the session, or maybe now if you want to switch.
Welcome to my demo of creating a Citrix master image with Packer via Azure DevOps Pipelines. So at first we want to connect our Azure repository to our local Visual Studio Code so we can edit the files. When you go to Azure DevOps, you can click your project. So in my case, this is Born IT CI/CD Desktop. Within here, you can go to repositories and files. And here you can find the repository of our images code. And in this repository, all the files are stored describing our image. So for example, the Packer template or the installation script or the YAML files for the pipeline run. So if I want to edit this in Visual Studio Code, I just click clone and clone in VS Code, open, and Visual Studio Code will ask me, I really want to open this URL. I said, okay. Select a location where the repository is stored locally, and Visual Studio Code will use Git to clone the repository to my local storage. So when I press open, I can see the files in Visual Studio. So that's very easy. Let's first start investigate the Packer templates, which are actually my image description. So within the Packer templates, I defined two templates, Win10 multi-user for Azure and Windows Server 2019 for vSphere. So if you look at the files which are in the template, there are actually three HCL files. And HCL stands for HashiCorp language, and those files are stitched together when doing a Packer build. So let's first dig into the variables file. So in the variables file, I declared all the different variables used by the Packer template. So for example, the Azure AD application key and the Azure application ID, which is actually connects to my Azure tenant. I can mark some type of streams as sensitive by specifying sensitive is true. And when I specify the sensitive is true, the strings are not logged. So they're just replaced by stars. So the application key, for example, is not exposed in a log. If we look at the Packer template itself, you see these two sections here. One is source, which is actually the description of our Packer builder. And build, this is actually the task sequence of provisioners, which will in the end be our master image. So if we look to the source, so this is the Packer builder, I specified here Azure ARM. So if we look to the vSphere builder, I can specify, for example, here vSphere ISO to specify a vSphere build via an ISO file. As you can see here, different parameters are needed per builder type. So in this case, I need to define the cluster where my builder VM is deployed. And if I look to Azure, I need to define the resource group where my builder VM is deployed, for example. When building a Packer image on Azure, it's very important not using a public IP. So if you enable this, a public IP will be attached to the builder VM, and yeah, you can publicly connect to Windows Remote Management. And I think you don't want that. And as you can see here, all the parameters are linked to a variable. So in this case, it's the AZVM image offer. Those variables are specified in the pkrvars file. So for example, for this image, an Azure virtual machine size of B2MS is deployed in West Europe. If we look at the build, then we see here that it's using the builder on Azure, like the source, this is what we say seen above, Azure ARM, Windows 10 multi-user born IT AZ. This is the label over here. When starting the build, Packer will first execute this provisioner. This is just an inline PowerShell script installing Chocolaty, then installing 7-zip via Chocolaty, Notepad++, and build a manifest file. So we can use this, for example, as an artifact, so we know where the VHD is stored after the build. In my build, I specified the most variables for my builder in a pipeline. So for my pipelines, I specified a Packer builder vars file. And here I specified all the information used by the Packer build. So for example, my subscription ID, application ID, my builder temporary resource group name, which will be actually RG Packer build. And when the build started, put the build number as a postfix. And some variables are retrieved from the key vault. So I specify them here as retrieved from the key vault so that I do not have to specify this in code and store this on my repository. When you look at the Packer job and we look at the Packer build, you see here that I specify during the build all the different parameters from the pipeline to a variable which we declared in Packer. So for example, the Azure AD application ID, this is the Packer variable, and this is my pipeline variable. And I also uses the pkrvars.hcl file of the template as an input. So this was the file where we specified, for example, in which location the builder VM is built, or what type of marketplace image is used. This was this file. So okay, let's deploy this image to Azure. To deploy this image on Azure, we go back to Azure DevOps. And since we specified not using a public IP for our builder, it's mandatory to use a self-hosted Azure DevOps agent, since we need to have a network connection to the private IP of the builder VM. And the public Azure DevOps agents from Microsoft cannot connect to your private IP addresses. So when you go to project settings, agent pools, we see an agent pool here, which is Windows Azure NPM, which is hosting my Microsoft Partner Network subscription. And if we look to the agent, I just installed it on my WVD host, session host, and it's up to date and it's online. So I can use this for my pipeline run. When you want to run a pipeline, we just go to pipelines. We see here Azure Windows 10 Multi-User Born IT Azure. And I simply press run pipeline. So these are the parameters which I specified on the YAML pipeline. And yeah, these are correct, so I can just hit run. Now the pipeline is starting. And you see it's a multi-stage pipeline. So the first step is to actually create the image, and the second step is to copy it to the right location. And now the build is started. And I will actually go to the point that it starts creating the image. Okay, the actually build is started, as you can see here. Here is the output and the logging of the Windows 10 multi-user Azure Packer build immutable image. So as you can see here is that a temporary resource group is created called RG Packer build Windows 10 with the build number. So you can see here the build number, and which is actually the build number of the run. The location is West Europe, and it's now creating temporary resources in Azure. So let's switch to Azure. So if we go to resource groups, we're seeing the same resource group here. As you can see, Packer created temporary resources in the temporary resource group. You can identify them with the prefix of PKR. And the rest of the names are generated by Packer. So every run, the PKR virtual machine will have a different name. So it generates a virtual machine with a corresponding network card and a key vault. And in the key vault, a certificate is stored to connect securely to Windows Remote Management. Packer will delete those resources when it's done with the Packer run. So it's still creating an image. And as you can see here, it's installed Chocolaty. And it's now installing Notepad++ and 7-Zip. So it's downloading 7-Zip and installing it to the image. As you can see here. So the Packer build has finished. It took about 13 minutes to build the entire image. As you can see here at the end, the Packer builder is shut down and it's deleted from Azure. At first it captured the VHD from the builder VM. So if we go back to Azure and we go back to resource groups, we can refresh here. And we're seeing here that the default the temporary resource group is removed. If we look to our images in our containers, images, I see here the most recent image, which is Windows 10 Multi-User Born IT Azure, and it's the 18th build of the image. So these images can be deployed to our virtual machines in Azure with Citrix Machine Creation Services. So we now deployed our image on Azure, and if I run the pipeline for vSphere, it will actually do the same process, only then on vSphere. Like, it's now giving us the output on vSphere, and it created a VM called Packer with the Packer run number in it. And when this Packer build is done, you can use a snapshot of this image to deploy this with Citrix Machine Creation Services. Or maybe you want to make a provisioning service image of this, so you can deploy it with provisioning services.
Well, to wrap this Packer build up, I try to made a diagram of the whole process with Azure DevOps. So basically, we started first defining our image and all our install scripts of that used by that
Packer template in our Azure repository so we can source control it. Then we're using a pipeline to execute everything on an Azure DevOps self-hosted agents, which can access the private IP later in the process. So the Azure DevOps self-hosted agent will download the repository and then install Packer. So it can actually use Packer, and it will use the specified Packer template. So in this case, the Windows 10 multi-session. Based and specified in the Packer template, a temporary builder VM is created. So in this example, it's on Microsoft Azure, but it could also be on other platforms like VMware vSphere. When the temporary builder VM is ready, the provisioners are executed on the builder VM, and the PowerShell scripts are executed over there. You could use the Evergreen module, Chocolaty or Winget to get the latest and greatest install script. So your CI/CD Evergreen, and we are using, for example, Azure Files to store our EXA and MSC files, which we are installing on the Packer Builder. If you want to save and also source control things which are in here, you can save file hashes to your installation script so you can check it if the executable or the MSI file on Azure Files is still the same. So when the Packer Builder VM is successfully done, all the provisioners in the build, so the task sequence is complete, then the temporary builder VM is shut down. The VHD or image is copied from the temporary builder VM to a shared image gallery or your VHD in a storage account, and then the builder VM is removed from the Azure environment. So this is basically the whole process of building an image as code via Azure DevOps using Packer. And after the summer break, I will make a blog and put everything on GitHub so you can also see the scripts. So this is the end of our presentation. And I want to say thank you, and also for Rick. And if there are any questions, please reach out to us, or I don't know if there are any questions right now.
Yes, we have noted down some questions.
Cool.
So I'll kick off, because I know Roel is also dying to ask his questions, but ladies first. So yeah, I guess that's me. So the one question that I do have is, at the beginning, you said that you both know that there are a lot of different tools, different DevOps tools, methodologies to get to an end goal, like your as code goal that you have. Do you think that it's important to pre-select some standard tooling within your project? Or do you feel DevOps methodologies are flexible enough to do like a bring your own tools for engineers that are building the CI/CD pipelines?
Good question. If I'm doing this, the most code you're writing is common. For example, your infrastructure as code in your Terraform script. So you can easily transfer that, for example, from Azure repository to a Git repository. So that's not a problem. So I think you just need to select the tools which you are familiar with and which is the best for your project goals. And if that's Azure repos with pipelines, that's okay. But you can also use, for example, Git with GitHub Actions or Jenkins. And as what I've learned now, I've seen a lot of demos about Jenkins, is that if you know the flow about building your infrastructure via a pipeline and you could choose to use Jenkins, you can just translate the Azure DevOps pipeline run to a Jenkins pipeline. And basically, yeah, it looks different, but it does the same.
Yeah, that's true. And Esther, to add to it, it also depends on the organization. If you're a large scale organization and you adopted Azure DevOps, for example, then it's easier between teams that engineers move across teams and using the same tools so that you standardize in that way. It's good to have teams have their own tool sets, but in certain level, you want to standardize also a bit. And it's also the advantage of the how advanced is the team. You know, if you got really good diehard DevOps programmers, they work with the tools you throw at them. If you have to start learning with one, yeah, I would say make a good do your requirements and make a selection of it.
Yeah, that makes sense. And that's what I experience as well. That for me, it's easy to adapt to a different scripting language or a different declarative language. But yeah, for those that are just doing their first baby steps, then it definitely helps to already have a standardization and a tool selection pre-selected instead of basically having them have to figure out how many different languages and tools they have to master. So thanks for that answer. So Roel, do you have another question?
Yes. Last month we had a speaker who had a very specific preferred feature of Azure DevOps pipelines, and I was wondering if you had any favorite features of that as well.
Of Azure DevOps pipelines? good question. I don't have found one yet, and if the Azure DevOps pipeline doesn't support something, I just build it myself in PowerShell. And output it to the pipeline and use it again. So I don't have a specific feature I'm using there.
And the multi-stage pipeline what we're using with the approvals and all the flow attached to it, yes, and integrate with ITSM, that's something I see as a really good added value. But like Patrick said, if the feature is not there, then we'll find a way around to get that integrated anyway. So. Was there a specific feature he mentioned that you can share with us?
I'm curious.
Yeah, you mentioned curious. Yeah.
Last month it was the templates feature. So being able to template stuff out and reuse it multiple times in.
Basically, we are also doing that with the ITSM changes. There's our Cloud Content Center created a template of it, so we can just use it in our pipelines by just specifying some parameters, and then you can lock or close a change. Oh, that's an awesome feature.
Can I do one more, Esther?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
All right.
So I'm learning new stuff too. So
I built a couple of pipelines as well. And for me, debugging them can be a real pain sometimes, because sometimes your fifth step in a pipeline, which takes 6 minutes, fails, and you still need the other four. So are there any tips you guys have for debugging while building pipelines?
Good question. And maybe for the infrastructure as code, and maybe that's a common tip or advice, if you're starting with it, just run it first from your laptop. And as I mentioned with Packer, and another guy was giving a great tip, if you want to try your build and it fails there, you can just install VirtualBox for free on your machine, run Packer without a pipeline, and just see if your task sequence is working, and you can troubleshoot it very quickly. And if your Packer template is right, then put it in the pipeline, and then you know the first step will automatically be succeeded, and then focus on the next step. And sometimes I'm trying also to make multiple stages, so I can reschedule the second stage. If you schedule a pipeline, you can just skip the first stage, and if you make the second stage not that dependent on the first stage, or give some parameters to the second stage so it can reuse the thing which succeeded in the first stage, you don't have to wait on the first stage all the time.
That's an awesome tip. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
So I guess this means, due to the time, I just want to say thank you very much, guys, for sharing your experiences and the tips and tricks that you discovered adapting to an Azure DevOps, a CI/CD way of life, so to speak. And I guess there's still room for like a quick bio break. And then please come back as soon as you can to join us with the next presenter.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us, guys, and as and girls, and have a great evening.
Thank you, guys.